This is Colleen Francis from Engage Selling Solutions. Thank you so much for joining us here on our live broadcast. Whether you're joining us from Facebook or LinkedIn or YouTube, whether you're watching this live or you're here on the replay, we are really happy to have you here. As we get started today, a couple of things I'd love to know and hear from you. First of all, I wanted to make sure that you knew, if you didn't already know, that I have a brand new book out called Right on the Money. It is available on Amazon or Apple Books or I think Books a Million, Indigo if you're in Canada. And if you've got a copy of it, if you've purchased a copy of it and you love it and are implementing, as I know you are, I would love for you to post a review on the bookstore that you purchased it from so that we can see a few of your reviews. And I'd also love for you to send me an email or write in the comments here what you've been implementing and the success you've been having. I should also congratulate publicly the winners of our contest. First of all, thank you for everybody who participated in our book contest. I was excited to have participation from all over the world. We have mailed out your books. Some of them might take a little long to get there because I know we sent one to New Zealand and I think we sent one to Germany. We sent one to South Africa. I think we even sent one to India. So, and one just around the corner from me in Hamilton. So thank you guys so much for participating in that contest. And of course, I also wanted to let you know that the offer still stands. We've actually got quite a few of our customers who bought 10 copies or more and are taking advantage of the free webinar for their teams. So that's the easiest, quickest, and least expensive way to get a free webinar from me if you're interested in that. So as we're getting started here, I would love always for people to chime in on where they're viewing from. We've got a really interesting topic today because I've been inspired by all the podcasts that I've been doing. I guess it's no surprise that if I've been launching a new book, if we get on the podcast, the interview circuit. And one of the things that I think is really fascinating is I'm asked all the time what's changed in the marketplace and how can sellers take advantage of it. I see that Lori is already starting to take advantage of this because she has just landed a new client, which I love. So thank you very much for sharing that, Lori, and thanks for being here. Charlie from Austin, thanks for being here. I love Austin and miss Austin and looking forward to an opportunity to come back so that I can have some of your wonderful food because honestly, the food in Austin is some of the best in the US. And Jamie from Barrie, Ontario, I'm excited to be coming your way in a few weeks. I'll be on vacation up near Port Severn and we always pass through Barrie and we always stop at Costco. I have a great client in Barrie. So it's wonderful to have you here too. So thank you guys so much for being here. We've got people from all over the world, the Netherlands, Crystal City, Texas, Orlando, Florida. Stay cool and out of the sun, Kimberly, because I know it's brutally hot down there. And be careful of the weather this weekend. I hear you guys are getting a bit of a storm. So enough with all the chatter. Shall we get started? So one of the things that people ask me, whether they're podcasters or media people or sales professionals like you is, you know, what's changed? What's changed in the market? And, you know, especially what's changed even since you wrote your last book 7 years ago? Why did you write this one? And I always laugh at this because there's one significant change that I don't really point out specifically, but I think it's really important for us to discuss. In Nonstop Sales Boom, which I wrote 7 years ago, I wrote and dedicated an entire chapter to identifying recognizing and selling to your ideal buyer. In fact, I gave you maps and models on how to create this ideal buyer, this avatar of who you should be selling to ideally. In Right on the Money, we actually have a chapter, I think it's chapter 4 or chapter 5, where it's actually called There's No Such Thing as an Ideal Buyer. So, you know, in a few short years, we've gone from there, you only sell to your ideal buyer to there is no such thing as an ideal buyer. Now, of course, I mean, there's ideal buyers in corporations, right? There's only certain markets and certain segments that you sell to. So I don't mean that. What I mean is that inside those companies, there isn't one ideal person that we should be targeting anymore. There's a quote from my mentor, Alan Weiss. He always says, you never know where your next hit is going to come from. Now, he was talking about it in terms of marketing and advertising. But honestly, in our business, it applies because what it means is we never know where that next referral is going to come to from or where the influence is going to come from. And we're seeing all sorts of success in sales with people targeting, talking to others inside the corporation that they've never spoke to before, and they become the key levers of influence for the sale. So I'll give you a couple of examples here. One of my clients in the oil and gas commercial industrial markets for lubrications and fuels and greases, engine oils, things like that. They had been trying to get into a monster manufacturing company for years. This company made the disc brakes that go on the big tires of the big, you know, Freightliner type trucks. They couldn't get in their normal channels. They were targeting that ideal buyer. They could not get in through maintenance. They could not get in through, you know, the guy who runs the factory. They could not get in through operations or even the general manager. And one day he was out networking and he was chatting with somebody in this company who was with customer service. And they got talking about how things were going. And the customer service person revealed that they were overworked, just stressed to the max, because they were working through some client issues and were at risk of losing one of their biggest customers due to a manufacturing defect that they could not figure out. And the plant was just flummoxed. No one could figure out what the problem was. The disc brakes were coming off faulty and warped, which, of course, we don't want on those big 18-wheelers. And my client recognized that it was a problem that could be solved with lubrications, fuels, greases, engine oils. But, you know, these are not things that I'm an expert in, but he is, and he recognized that. He was able to talk to the customer service person, escalate this through to the VP of customer service and sales, and use that as a point of leverage to get in the door and win the business. Now, that was alternative, right? He had never sold through the sales and customer service channel, but it won him a piece of business that was six figures over multiple years and continuing. It probably is now a $1 million piece of business. And of course, because they solved the problem, saved their customers, allowed sales to continue to work successfully, the customer is exceptionally loyal. Not only are they loyal, they're referring them to all of their suppliers. He's become an industry expert, kind of an industry icon, really. And so that's what I mean by this non-traditional buyer. One of the things we have to consider doing here is think about the non-technical aspects or the non-technical value that we bring with our products. And what I mean by that is, if we go back to this example, you know, in terms of engine oils and lubricants and greases, these sellers know all the technical aspects, right? I mean, they're engineers. And so they know what the product does. They know what it solves. They know, you know, how much to use. They know what the drain intervals are. They know the viscosities, right? They know all of those technical aspects. But what they had to do to win this sale was focus on the non-technical side, meaning customer relationships, the ability to generate revenue, brand reputation. And when they did that, they were able to put pressure on the organization for a win. When I say technical, I mean small t technical. I mean, we have to focus on the value that we bring that's not in the core value of the product. So another example from the manufacturing industry. So a client of mine makes equipment that speeds up the process of manufacturing. And they do that through a lot of automation. And of course, they know the technical aspects, the value that they bring in automation, speed, throughput, you know, fewer employees, blah, 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 right? Competitive advantage. But what they'd never talked about was also employee workplace and safety until they were on one site who they were having a real problem up against roadblock of a company that didn't want to install these automated or robotic systems because the price point was high, $25,000 plus per system. And so the sale was just being stalled. And then one day in the meeting was an HR person who was in charge of workplace health and safety. And this person made a comment about whether it would reduce workplace compensation claims. And that conversation had never come up before. Of course, the customer said, well, yes, because, you know, there's less repetitive strain. Is that an issue for you? Now, everyone on the maintenance floor said, no, absolutely not. Not an issue. We don't have any claims. We don't have any problems. But what HR knew that nobody else knew is there were a lot of complaints, but no one was willing to file because of the employee base, right? New immigrant base, not a lot of English spoken in an American company, concerned that they wouldn't get paid their wage if they filed a claim, concerned they'd get fired. You know, a lot of fear there in just new workers to a new place. They needed their jobs. And HR knew this and hadn't been able to figure out a solution. But by putting pressure and revealing this to the rest of the organization, we were able to move forward with some high value robotics equipment. So again, really important. What's the non-product value, you know, that your product can bring? And when you think about that, then it opens up a whole world of influencers and advisors that you can be selling to. I want you to think about buying today as buying in a community. You know, when I was selling technology 25 years ago or so, we used to talk about people buying by committee, right? And in that committee, there was always formal people. You know, I would have these sheets, blue sheets, gold sheets, yellow sheets, whatever they were, you know, back if I was doing solution selling or any other methodology. And we'd say, who is the technical buyer? Who's the financial buyer? Who's the user buyer? Who's the stakeholder buyer? And these were all people on a committee that were very formal, right? A community is not formal. A community of influence is all the people around the person who ultimately can say yes and sign the PO, who that person listens to. And they could be people adjacent to them, above them, below them. They could be people outside the company, in their friends' network. It could even be their family, depending on who it is you're selling to. And if you start asking your questions like, okay, we deliver X value, who else in the company should be interested in that? Or force yourself to say, okay, we deliver X value to the, we deliver value to the sales VP because we're helping to train their sales reps to be more effective. Okay, why should HR care about that? Well, HR should care about that because a more effective sales team makes more money, which leads to less turnover and also creates an employee of choice culture, which makes it easier for them to recruit. Okay, a more effective sales force also means that the sales force is happy and productive, less burnout, which means that there's going to be less time off, less stress on benefits. Okay, so that's how HR could benefit. How could the development side of that, you know, if it's software development, why should they care? Well, more access to customers, more user feedback, better opportunity to create new functions and features. Obviously, development teams, if you're selling more, they might need more employees and expansion opportunities to build out their teams. So that's why they should care. Why should finance care? You know, why should the owners care? Why should operations care? If it's a manufacturing or a physical product, why should your team of drivers care? And if you ask that about every single, you know, line group, every single functional business category inside the organization, you start to develop this value matrix that is invaluable because you've operationalized your value. And I think that that is critical because what it does is it helps to ensure that you're not commoditized. So I know I've come at you sort of hard and fast here for the first 12 minutes of our class, but this is something that is, obviously you can tell I'm super passionate about, because what we've found in this marketplace is that we can't afford as salespeople to commoditize ourselves. right? If you look, act, and sound the same as every single other salesperson out there, then you've commoditized yourself, even in a marketplace that might not be selling a commodity, a true commodity. But when that happens, then the buyer loses confidence, the buyer has a harder time making a decision, and the buyer really only has price and availability as their two differentiating factors. And we all know that that's dangerous. We don't want to sell just on price and availability. So selling to the people that your competition isn't talking to is a way to differentiate. And it's not that hard. It just takes a little bit of creative thinking and a little bit of work finding those extra people that you should be talking to. So one way to start is to talk to your existing customers. Ask to speak to all the other line managers. Ask HR how they're benefiting. You know, ask the legal team how they're benefiting. Ask finance how they're benefiting. Ask operations and development how they're benefiting. Have a little advisory or user panel inside your own clients and start to gather that information so then you can use that to talk to other people like them in other organizations. Wonderful. I see we've got someone here from South Africa. Thank you for being here. One of my favorite countries to visit. Can't wait to come back. Appreciate you logging in at, must be like, I don't know, seven o'clock your time, I think. Maybe 6 o'clock. I'm not sure how the daylight savings works there. I'm just scrolling through to see if anybody has any questions or comments. I don't see any questions. So I do want to make sure that you guys ask any questions that you have as we're going through this. To summarize, we've just started with talking about some of the changes that I'm seeing. And this big one is this change from having an ideal customer to not having an ideal customer and really being open and creative to broaden and operationalize the value that you bring. Ah, thank you for correcting me. It's only 5:30. Okay, so you're 6 hours ahead of us. Well, thank you for joining me at the end of your day. One of the other changes that we're seeing, and you know, this is even more so since I wrote this, because I finished writing Right on the Money, you know, last year. What are we, 2022? So 2021, it was published in 2022. And something that I have really noticed in the last 5 months is the amount of exhaustion and frustration in our community. You know, I think that in 2020 and 2021, we were dealing with an exhausted and frustrated buyer, and there's probably some of that right now, but we worked harder than ever before. Dealing with lockdowns, trying to figure out who to talk to when our clients weren't working, adjusting our strategies, learning new technologies. And let's face it, being in front of a screen all day is more exhausting than being in front of a customer physically. And I think we're starting to see the cumulative effects of that because more sales VPs are telling me more than ever right now that their teams are exhausted and frustrated. Now, the frustration is coming because many of you are in situations where you're having multiple price increases, right? I had a client last year, I think, go through 6 price increases. Some of you are in markets where maybe you're leading those price increases and the competition hasn't yet decided to join you. And you're facing supply chain shortages, right? In January, February of this year, I was besieged with, you know, owners and sales managers saying, like, we'd be having the best quarter yet if we could just get product. I have clients saying, man, it's the best year yet for my industry that I sell to, and I can't get product to them. Distributors that I work with are screaming, you know, to their manufacturing partners saying, you know, if you could just get me product, I could be the number one distributor. And that hurts sales reps. It's hurting our commissions. It's hurting our morale. It's hurting our relationship with customers. And so that exhaustion and frustration is very real right now. And I wanted to talk about a couple of things here. One, to the sales reps, if this is you, please take some time off. North Americans are notoriously, I'm speaking mostly to North Americans and especially to Americans right now, but anyone else who might fall into this category, we are notoriously terrible at taking all the vacation that's allotted to us. And even when we do take vacation, we keep our cell phones close and we answer email. We think, oh, can't bad. I'll just deal with a few company things before I take off for the day. I would encourage you to get out of that habit. Be more European, to actually take some time off. If you're scared to do that, just take a day, right? Or a half day, baby steps, but take some time off, relax, recharge, get outside, have a nap, meditate, do some exercise, play with your kids, whatever that looks like for you. I'm not the expert, of course, in all of those things, but I do know that you can't be functional, productive, and add value to your clients if you're exhausted and frustrated, right? That affects your mental game. Now, for sales managers out there, two things. One, you have to have highly tuned emotional intelligence right now. If your team or a team member is showing signs of frustration and exhaustion, you've got to send them home. You've got to give them some time to rest and recharge, because if you don't, two things are going to happen. One, they're going to become dysfunctional with their customers and their teammates, and their productivity will go down, which is going to contribute to more frustration, and they will leave. And let's face it, I think one of the biggest changes that we're seeing in the market in general is the sheer volume of poaching that's going on between companies. Headhunters are having a field day. And my clients are reporting that they've never seen so much headhunting activity every day in their businesses. People just calling in, trying to recruit their salespeople for other jobs. And those jobs are often well paid with good benefits. And if your sales team feels like you don't care, or you don't give a rip, as we say in Canada, that you won't let them take vacation, that you're telling them to just suck it up and keep moving, they will leave. It's not just about the money. It's about the culture, and it's about the leadership. At the end of the day, what we find is that 67, so two-thirds of salespeople leave managers. They leave situations. They leave cultures. They don't leave because of the money. The two sort of go hand in hand, because if you had a good culture, good leadership, good coaching, good emotional intelligence, they probably would be making more money, right? But they feel like they can't in an environment that doesn't let them relax, reset, and recharge as they need to. And so I think that this is, you know, it's both an emotional problem. It's an objective problem and a subjective problem. You know, if you are one of those hard driving sellers or sales VPs who's just like, you know, bring me in the numbers, suck it up, let's just get it done. You have to recognize that without that downtime, without that recovery time, your team can't be productive. It's consider it the off season. As a sales rep, if you're the same way, you've got to recognize that you have to rest. Think of yourself as a highly tuned athlete. Physically, you know, you got to rest. That's why there's football players don't play every single day. They practice and they rest. And we have to do exactly the same thing. It's more important than ever before. So I wanted to answer this question from Kiropetse. Hopefully I pronounced your name correctly. The world of sales has become increasingly competitive. How can one maximize their empathetic approach to sales? This is a great question. Thank you for asking. Because empathy is really important right now. Right? Every customer is different, and every business is different. Every stakeholder you talk to is going to be different. One of the ways that we can do this is to ask questions. I know that sounds pretty basic, but we need to be asking questions. We also need to be bringing people new ideas and insights. So I think we can approach our customers empathetically by saying, hey, this is what we're seeing at other companies. How are you handling that? This is what we see coming down the pipe. You know, if you look forward into the future, this is what regulation or compliance we're hearing about. How are you preparing for that? Here's an example of a best practice in your industry. Are you interested in seeing how we can apply that to you? And so I think if you ask questions and bring them new ideas and insights and really focus on helping them improve their business, even if that means they don't have to pay you right away, that is how you increase your competitive advantage using empathy. So for example, a client of mine that sells in the industrial space, their company has a huge focus on health and safety. And what their sales reps do as part of the sales process, but really for free, to again, improve their competitive advantage and show empathy, is while they're walking through the factory floor, meeting people and trying to understand the business and learning about how they can help them with their paid services, they point out safety violations, compliance issues, product contamination risk. And sometimes they're just really simple things. You should have a lid on that because that cable should be taped down. Sometimes they're significant. That oil tank is sitting on top of a city storm drain, you know. you shouldn't be moving those things with forklifts, you know. But all of that advice is given for free. And the customer can actually improve their operation, improve their productivity and their profitability if they implement those things without giving my client a dime. But it does lend itself to more business because they're showing a generosity of knowledge. And this is another thing that I have seen really change. Like when I first started selling technology, so it was when I first moved to Ottawa, which I think was 1997, I was trained in a methodology that's still around, I'm not going to name it, that said no free consulting. Right? No free consulting. If you give consulting away for free, you'll never get paid. And in fact, when I started my consulting business at Engage Selling 21 years ago, I got an opportunity to speak in front of a large audience for free. And one of my colleagues said to me, Colleen, if you speak to them for free, you will never get paid. But I was new to the business. I wanted the practice. It was close to home. So I took it anyways. Didn't really, you know, I was like, oh, well, worst case scenario, I get practice. The reality is I ended up doing six figures with that client over the course of a number of years because of my generosity. So I believe that no free consulting mantra that I was taught, in 1997, 1998 is actually like out the door. It is not applicable anymore. Today, we win business by being generous with our material. So look at my business, right? And let's just use me, Engage Selling. You're here for free, learning a ton, right? I'm giving you away content that's in the book. I'm giving you away content that people pay to hear me speak about. You can go to my website, download all of my newsletters, listen to all of my videos. You can watch my keynote addresses for free. And if you implement it, I guarantee you, you will make more money and succeed without paying me a dime. Yet, that's how we win all of our business. People watch that and they think, man, I learned so much from her. She made so much sense for free. Just imagine what will happen when I pay her. And you all, no matter what you sell, whether you sell pharmaceuticals or financial services or technology or groceries, you all have that opportunity to give that away for free, not your product, but your advice, so that you drive more people into your business. A client of mine runs a chain of gas stations and they have like quick lubes in the gas stations. And they do a whole series on car maintenance for women. And they bring women in, they teach them how to, you know, change the oil, change the fluids, all those things, all stuff that people pay them to do in their quick lubes. Yet that advice creates goodwill in the marketplace, which creates more business for them. So can you write how-to tips? Can you do videos? Can you interview your clients? Could you be using platforms like this to really help your clients understand the value of what you bring? Could you be sharing your expertise in ways that cause clients to learn from it and then be interested in doing business with you? So that's how I really think that you differentiate yourself in this marketplace and show empathy by being generous with your information, by bringing them new ideas and insights, by asking questions, and of course, like what we were talking about before, by making sure that you're reaching out to multiple people inside the organization. Ultimately, You show empathy and are generous and really differentiate yourself from the competition when, say, the owner of the business says, wow, no one else has shown me how every single department in my organization is going to benefit from this solution. That's what you're looking for. So we've been talking about a couple of the changes in the marketplace and how to leverage them. One being the fact that there's no such thing as an ideal buyer anymore. And you can read more about that in Nonstop Sales Boom if you don't have a copy of it. You should get one. We've also talked about the importance of mental health with sellers right now. I mean, just imagine this, right? You're tired and frustrated and exhausted, and your clients are tired and frustrated and exhausted, and you get into a meeting. Woo, that's a recipe for an explosion, right? We don't want that. We've also talked about how the competition is stiff, and we really need to make sure that we're differentiating ourselves in the sales process more than ever before, so we don't commoditize ourselves. We have to be empathetic, and we have to be generous. And lastly, I want to talk a little bit about how a major change in the marketplace over the last year, and this isn't something I wrote about specifically in the book, but we've been talking a lot about it recently, is the inexperience of buyers in the marketplace. So we had an exodus of people out of business. I was just at the dentist, and they pulled hygienists in out of retirement because they can't even get dental hygienists because so many people have left or retired or gone to do other things, right? So we've seen this exodus of senior level leaders out of their business roles to do other things or to retire or to consult or start businesses. And as a result, we have this whole new crop of younger buyers, inexperienced buyers, stakeholders, people in management positions coming in to fill their roles. And they're inexperienced because they haven't been in these roles before, and they have no mentors because the mentors have all left. So this creates a lack of confidence in our communities of interest where people are going to make decisions. So what do we have to do about this? There's a few things. One, we have to go back to that buying community that we talked about and make sure we're influencing all the people who are influencing our buyer, okay? Two, we have to build confidence with this buyer. It's critical that we help them feel confident in themselves. And we do that by making sure that they have access to information on multiple channels. I recently came into contact with a survey that Google did, which was then recreated by another, a couple of other consultants who really focus on influence in the marketplace. And this is perfect alignment with critical mass influence, which I do talk about in the book. What they found is that in order for someone to be influenced by you positively and want to engage with you, so want to, you know, take a meeting, learn more about you, buy from you, they need to have consumed 7 hours of content. So by reading or watching or listening, 11 different times, so 11 different touch points. So 7 hours of content over 11 different touch points, right? So maybe it's a tweet here, a white paper there, a video here, a phone call on 4 different medias. So that could be a media, could be you having a conversation with them. They could be them on your website. It could be them watching video. And it could be them on, you know, LinkedIn or an association website. You are a type of media. So this is called the rule of 7-11-4. Now, maybe it's 11-7-4, but, you know, it's 7 hours, 11 contact points over 4 different media types. And that is when people start to feel influence. We call that critical mass influence in our business. And if you read Nonstop Sales, Right on the Money, we talk about critical mass influence and the tempo triad. And those two things together are how you execute on this rule of 7-11-4. I think it's critical. Every person that I'm working with right now, whether they be in oil and gas, agriculture, technology, finance, I'm trying to think of some of the other industries we're working on. Those would be the four major ones. They have all said they're selling to younger and younger buyers and younger experience levels. In fact, in the last 4 months, the number of people who said to me, "It's amazing, Colleen, my buyer doesn't know how to buy. My buyer doesn't even know if he needs a PO, who in purchasing to talk to, whether there's an approval process." We're having to walk our people, our buyers, through their own organization because they've never done it before. And that lack of experience leads to a lack of confidence. And if they're not confident in themselves, they're not going to be confident in you. And if they're not confident in themselves and you, then they're not going to buy. So keep this in mind, the rule of 7-11-4, 7 hours of content over 11 different touch points and 4 different medias. And to the LinkedIn user who says 7 hours may be too much info, no, I mean, not 7 hours at once. You're absolutely right. 5 to 7 minute max. So 7 hours is actually going to be over weeks or months, right? So they might watch a 5 minute video and then they might download a white paper and that could take them 30 minutes to read. And then they think, oh, you know, that's really cool. I think I'm going to request a demo. And then they say, you know what, I think I want to talk to you. And they pick up the phone and you have an hour long conversation. So I don't mean 7 hours of them sitting, you know, at their desk, right? I mean 7 hours over, it could be the course of 7 months, right? Your buyers, and we've known this for years, your buyers are doing inordinate amounts of research behind the scenes before they ever raise their hand and say they're ready to talk to you. You know, that 7 hours could be also them at a trade show, listening to your CEO speak or spending time at your at a trade show booth. So I don't want you to think about it in large chunks. Definitely, as you say, think about it in terms of 5 to 7 minutes max. And you know what? What if the numbers are, you know, 5 hours over, you know, 10 touch points and 3 different kinds of media? I mean, that to me is almost inconsequential. Because I can guarantee you it's not 1-1-1. It's certainly not 1, right? This is the mistake we make with sales, and it's the mistake we make when we challenge the numbers. Don't even think about it in absolutes. Just think about it as multiples. Are you doing enough? Are you talking to enough people across enough multimedia channels and producing enough content? I guarantee you that most of you are not, because in the work that I'm doing now, I see very few companies who are prolific at publishing content that their customers, prospects, influencers, stakeholders, communities can consume in a unique way on a regular basis. So I would encourage you to take a look at the two chapters, chapters 3 and 4 on critical mass influence in the tempo triad. We talk about using 3 different medias 3 times a week, doing 3 different things. And we talk about 4 different masses of influence that you want to create. If you just start there, you'll soon be at the point where the 7-11-4 rule will kick in. Awesome, guys. Well, this has been a really fun broadcast. You know, just as a quick recap for those of you who might be just joining, we've talked about changes in the marketplace that I've been seeing. We talked about the absence of an ideal buyer and how you have to leverage a buying community. We've talked about the exhaustion and frustration in the marketplace and how mental health awareness is critical for managers and sellers. And my plea for all of you to take some time off. We've talked about the inexperience of buyers in the marketplace and how our role is to build confidence in themselves and in us. And we've also talked about the how to differentiate yourself against the competition and how to be generous and empathetic. You know, I think that what's really critical here is for you to pick something from this. I know I threw a lot of content at you, but pick something from our conversation here and start implementing right away. The faster you implement and integrate what we've been talking about into your work, the more success you'll have. So thank you guys so much for being here with me today. We will be live again probably in mid-July. I am taking some time off later this month, and we'll be back in the office later in the second week of July. And it looks like we'll probably put a live broadcast on sometime around the 15th to 18th of July, where I'll be recharged, refreshed, and full of new ideas and success stories. So until that time, take care, stay in touch, keep the comments coming, and I look forward to hearing about your success. Thanks, everyone.